Continuing with Subversive Forum, it was our intention, together with Subversive Forum as organizers and Hannibal Foundation, to have this Wednesday as a day reserved for commons and commoners. So it was the main idea to present in the cycle of few workshops and few panels different aspects of the commons that relate to large extent to the issue of future of Europe, which is a central theme of the conference. During this day, in the next few hours, we will try to link current multiple crises with the issue of commons, and we will also deal specifically with urban commons and with digital commons, as those focuses we choose to, as they are very relevant also for the local discussion, but also in the most recent times internationally. In this workshop, in this panel, we are about to explore in which way commons can be not only as an interpretative tool, but also as a practice, can be a part of transformation of Europe, of social and economic relationships. And in this particular case, we will focus to which extent commons are can be understood as one of the ways that can help Europe to exit the crisis. For the beginning, I would like to invite Saki Bailey from International University of Turin, who will be our first speaker for a short introduction, mainly focusing on the legal aspects of the commons, putting the foundation for further discussion, and then we will have Giovanni Allegretti and Vinod Raina joining the panel with their contributions. So Saki, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Vedran, and I'm really encouraged that Heinrich Boll decided to devote a day to the commons and looking at the kinds of strategic, political, and legal tools that the commons might offer us in exiting the crisis. So I don't think I need to say much about the kind of crisis that we're in right now. I think every forum, every conference, every all over the media, we understand very well that we're in a serious economic crisis and that Greece, Spain, Italy, for example, are on the brink of collapse. So I think this is a moment in which people are searching for an alternative to the crisis but don't really understand what that could be, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how the commons might be that political strategy. So as Vedana mentioned, I'm from the International University College of Turin. Let me just say a little bit about what that is. I was supposed to actually be in the afternoon session on ACTA, but I'm actually stepping in for Ugo Mattei, who is a lawyer and comparative legal scholar and the founder of the International University. The International University is devoted to the study of the commons. It's a master's program with primarily students from the Global South, and it's devoted to not only academic projects, but strategic political projects. One of them, the one that we're pursuing at the moment, is the European Charter of the Commons. Now, what is the European Charter of the Commons? What is the basis, the history of this particular document? The basis for this is that this past April, just 1 month ago, the European Commission is now accepting European citizens' initiatives for the first time. This was a mechanism created under the Lisbon Treaty, but finally implemented in this year. What does the European Citizens' Initiative do? It basically allows for any kind of proposal which fits within, this is the trick, competence of the European Commission, as long as it's signed by a million signatures in over seven countries, okay? Now, I will get to the part of the trick, the difficulty of actually presenting something which fits within the competence of the European Commission. Because as we understand, the European Commission is an economic government. It's not a political government. As we know very well, the constitutional project was turned down. thanks to France and Holland, sorry if there's French and Dutch in this room, but the constitutional, the political project of Europe is basically dying, right? And this project of the European Charter is an attempt to challenge under this legal mechanism that's been created to pursue the political governance of Europe. So pursuing a constitutional project as opposed to the mere economic governance. So what exactly is the Charter addressing? The Charter is addressing the lack of legitimacy of politicians that supposedly represent us, the lack of faith in democracy as an institution, the neoliberal formulation of methods out of the crisis, the primary one being privatization. Privatization of resources, taking them out of the hands of citizens, austerity measures which are cutting social programs, with a kind of logic that you can only have rights to basic income, to fundamental resources, if there is wealth, if you can only split the pie if there is a pie in the first place. This is the concept, right? That you can only, that somehow social distribution and distributive justice issues are connected to the creation of wealth. And in times of recession, the first thing that goes are social programs. It's also addressing the severe imbalance of the corporate sector, of the power of the corporate sector. And again, this fits directly with the issue of privatization. Why is it that we have such collusion between state and market actors? I want to address one thing. So Vedran said, you know, we're looking for ways out of the crisis, looking at, you know, basically the issue of neoliberalism. And I want to just say a couple things about what neoliberalism is. We have this idea that neoliberalism is laissez-faire, okay? That it's this idea of uncontrolled market, that you create a space in which corporations can pursue their profit interests without state intervention. We have this idea that somehow the private sector is independent of the state sector. And I want to say that it's not. And in fact, the neoliberal project, what is unique about the neoliberal project, as opposed to the prior classical liberal project, is that it's about aggressive intervention by the state to create market conditions on behalf of corporations, okay? Originally, the concept was not corporations, it was the enterprise. It was the idea of creating something called the homo economicus, which we have all become and in fact is now turning against us. Why did it turn out to be corporations? Well, corporations were created as legal subjects in this century, and as a result, could accumulate wealth and have the same rights as human beings. But unlike human beings, they have a lifetime much longer than human beings. So it's no wonder that they are the most powerful actors in the landscape today. So let's talk about the approach of the Charter and addressing this particular problem and using the commons. So as I said earlier, just now about corporations being produced as legal subjects. So we believe that real structural change happens through the law. Okay, this is a particular approach. We can debate what's more important, but in the end, I think we're going to see that through my presentation, the political is very, very connected and intrinsic to the legal. But it's the idea that law produces certain kinds of subjects. Okay, so just like neoliberalism produced a certain kind of economic man, right, through regulation. Okay. This is law, regulation is law. Through law, it produced a certain kind of economic subject. Through the law, you can also create, for example, subjects of rights. So as citizens, we have certain rights to challenge the system. What does it really mean to have rights, okay? We can have all kinds of documents, and what we really try to avoid with this charter is to create another human rights document, okay? Another kind of grand declaration about abstract conception of rights, okay? Because real rights are the ones that are justiciable, the ones that you can actually walk into a court and claim for yourself. And so this is the idea, is that the way to combat this legal subject of homo economicus, which was produced by a neoliberal governance, is to produce a new kind of citizen, right? It's to reinvigorate the citizen, the subject of rights. It's also to produce a new kind of subject, which is the subject of maybe homo communis, the common man, right? So this is what I want to talk about in the most concrete case of Italy. So I've been talking in a rather large, introductory, abstract way about these issues. I want to bring this particular connection between law and politics and the creation of new subjectivity in the case of in the Italian case. So now what I'm getting to is the history of the charter. So where did this charter come from? Am I going good on time? Okay. So the history of the charter. So as I mentioned earlier, I'm stepping in for Ugo Mattei. Ugo Mattei was extremely important to a recent movement in Italy called the Acqua Bene Comune movement, or Acqua Pubblica. It was a huge referendum in Italy that took place last year. 27 million voters turned out for this referendum. It was the first quorum that was ever that happened in 16 years. 95% of the voters voted against privatization of water. Okay, so this was a major political action. Ugo was involved in this project both as in two ways, as an attorney and a politician, and in another sense also as a legal scholar. And what I want to get into is was this social political movement actually produced from legal tools? Okay, so the background on this particular referendum. The legge Galli was introduced in 1994. What did it do? It mandated the privatization of water, okay, in Italy. What did it result in? It resulted in tariffs over 60% of the original price over a period of 10 years, okay? So an increase of the price of water by 60%. Now, let's connect this back to the situation of Europe. Why do we care about the Italian case? Well, this phenomena actually happened all over Europe, right? So this case also happened in Paris and in Berlin, and a similar reaction actually happened in both of those cities. A retaking, right, of the water as a resource from the private sector. So the same kinds of increases in the price of water. So what is the bene comune? Okay, this is an extremely important question. So as much as it is important to say, what is the enemy that we fight when we talk about neoliberalism, which is something I think this is what is being thrown around, it is as important to say, what is the commons? Okay, and to have a kind of common discourse, common discourse, if I may, today about what it is when we talk about commons. Commons in the case of Italy is very different from the way that commons is being used in the academic discourse. So commons came into, I don't know how familiar everybody in the audience is with the idea of commons, but commons entered into the scene primarily through for Eleanor Ostrom, who won the Nobel Prize in 2006. So she won the prize for a particular reason, because she brought the academic discourse of economics into the more concrete empirical studies of political science. She's a political scientist who won the economics prize. And what did she do? She looked at particular case studies, a collection of case studies collected over a period of 30 years, which showed that, in fact, the tragedy of the commons, which was a term coined by Garrett Hardin in 1968, a famous article in Science magazine, which talked about the natural inclination, the natural property arrangement being the private one, okay, where an individual owns a certain plot of land. The Ostrom studies showed that, in fact, not all commons, not all land held in common actually deteriorated. In fact, in many cases, you actually saw such characteristics as sharing and cooperation and preservation of the resource. So this is the more academic discourse on commons, right? But what are we talking about when we're talking about today in the context of Europe and in the context of Italy? We're talking about commons as a political tool. So when in Italy they use this idea of bene comune was not in the Ostrom definition of the understanding that of what common pool resources are and how resources should be governed, but rather it's the recognition not of the fundamental nature through law of certain kinds of resources and the political resistance to claim ownership over their governance. Because I have so little time, I will I will condense a little bit, but I might go a little bit over. I'll put some things later for discussion. But the primary thing is this. So the law, in the case of Italy, several different legal sources, the case of the Rodotà Commission, for example, which proposed reform against the legge galli, against privatization, and suggested that, in fact, there was a place within the Italian constitution, Italian constitutional articles 41, 42, and 43, that provided a space for a third type of governance over goods called the commons, okay? And actually, my point is basically this today. Every single European constitution has measures like this. What are they? They put limits on private interests through public purpose, okay? Every single constitution has something like this. In the Italian case, it was used, I think, in a political and emancipatory way, and so this is a connection between law and politics, because through the reform, they understood that the constitution allowed for this category. What did this category do that was different from public goods? It actually brought, it created a place, a new legal subjectivity for something like homo communis, for a common man, for the regular person to be involved in the governance of their own resources. Today in Italy, statutes have been enacted in over 20 cities, including this mechanism for citizen participation in the governance of water. So the convergence of municipal law, of constitutional law, which allowed for the creation of this third category, as well as several other decisions in lower courts, created suddenly a legal basis for something called the bene comune, which then inspired the political movement, right? So what I'm suggesting today, and what the Charter is proposing, is not some kind of idealistic manifesto. I mean, there's plenty out there. And if we buy the idea of commons as an ideology, I think we're going completely the wrong way. The idea with the Charter is to encourage every citizens of every country to look at their own laws, to do something from the bottom up, as was done in Italy, to claim a place for the commons legally, to release the emancipatory potential of the law. Thank you.
Thank you, Saki. And exactly that is just a good departure point for Giovanni Allegretti, which will, to a large extent, also cover issue of participation and how actually a building of a common man can be a part of it.
Yeah, thank you very much also for the introduction that I think was important that Saki gave us. I was thinking to try to use some examples to clarify what David Harvey in his book Rebel Cities call commoning with the verb, which is the progressive construction of commons, a sort of creative appropriation of, in some cases, of already existing spaces or services for new ways of understanding our common interest and laying claim to common resources. So I would like to stress this idea of a process more than objects. Because I work with public participation, especially I work with participatory budgeting, which means in a period of crisis, helping people to understand that economy is not a given hell that we have to stand. It's just a matter of choices, and choices can be done in one direction or in another direction. I mean, this is trivial. We are here all with this conviction, but not always people has this conviction. So participatory budgeting is a sort of learning environment in which people, through participating to the construction of the choices with public resources, they start to understand that the choices can be done in different direction, and then they can be more or less showing solidarity one among the other, or they can be a space of appropriation by individuals. So I will start to tell a story of Malmo Water Services, which now is an agency called Vasit. In 2005, the liberal government of Malmo decided to open a tender to outsourcing the water services. And Veolia won, but in the second place, there was unexpectedly the Department of Water of the municipality, which participated in the concours and arrived in second place. There were elections in that period, and the new socialist mayor decided to stop the results of the tendering and say, if we have inside all this knowledge and skills, we were recognized by the jury as an important set of knowledge and capacity of management, why don't you use it? And they created, along 3 years, the VASID, which was quite different from the original department because it's a multi-city agency, which is now gathering new cities. Originally was just Malmo and Lund. And who has inside a series of participatory mechanism which directs at the same time to the workers. So for example, even things like the new C, the new logotype, the new slogans, they were decided together with the workers. And there is a lot of horizontalization of decision inside this agency. And then there are mechanisms for discussing with the citizens, like there is a committee on prices, for the readjustment on prices, and then there is a committee for disabled people to adequate the services to their needs. These instruments are not much used. Why? Because in Sweden, the cost of water is so insignificant that people is not losing time in participating in this mechanism. But the important is that those mechanisms are there. And in case of a shortage of water, which is not impossible in the area of Malmö, which is the area in all Sweden with biggest problems of water. There is a tunnel of 200 kilometers that brings water to Malmö. And so I think that it's very important in this case to see how was envisaged the idea of stepping back from outsourcing. I knew these cases when the municipality of Paris decided to remunicipalize water, and they asked to me and some other colleagues create like a sort of report with studying cities, different cities that had taken back water and were using participation of citizens in order to run it. The second example is from Porto Alegre. It's a set of examples trying to show that commons is like an organic, a sort of holistic vision of different measures that makes people understand what are interests of communities more than interests of small groups as individuals and individuals. In Porto Alegre, you know, there is a very strong process of participatory budgeting, which started in 1999. But I want to focus on some, and it was decided on 100% of the municipal investments, 100%. It's not all the budget, it's just a part of the budget for investments. And in 1996, the mayor, Tarso Genro, which now is the governor of the state, start to put under discussion bank loans of foreign donors because he wanted to make people understand that loans never comes for free. They always come with some conditionalities. And this conditionality can be negative for the people. And he wanted to clarify these conditionalities before starting to ask for loans to the banks. In 1998, there was a nice experience of a new shopping center in Villanova. Shopping centers, as many of the private developments on the territories, are usually considered the space of maneuver of executives because they allow negotiation and sometimes also private advantages for the politicians involved. And in this case, the municipality, there was the new mayor, Raul Pont, decided to put under discussion with not only the citizen of the area, but also a larger sample of citizens around the city, just to understand that this was something that was bringing positive and negative effect for all the city. So the Villanova shopping center was in an area where there are are a lot of cultivation of peaches, but these peaches have a very high quality, which is after 24 hours that you take from the tree, the high quality dies. So they cannot be in the market economy because they cannot stay like stones like the other peaches for 2 weeks there until someone buys them. So the problem was to create a short term use of these peaches. And the people proposed some major measures very different from the traditional measures, which are normally building parking lots and building streets around the shopping center. They said two things that were very interesting. The first one was that the center would have to commit to integrate one-third of the personnel of the center, taking them from the people who had lost their job because the small shops were closing in the area. And that those people to be reinserted in the market job were has to be people up to 45 years. So the type of people that the market would not reabsorb automatically. And the other thing was to create, the shopping center had to pay like a registered trademark for the pitches in the area and grant space for this high quality but low short lasting pitches. So two very immaterial somehow measure, very different from the traditional. In 1999, the municipality decided to create the so-called areas of priority occupation, which are some area marked in the master plan, in which you, if you don't build in the time of 1 year, so you wait for a waiting speculation for the prices to rise, you will have your taxes on property double every year. And this will be marked in the municipal register. So if you sell them, they will be sold with the obligation of pay double or triple taxes every year. So this experiment has been done by a municipality and was very difficult to do because it's going against the freedom of private property, who was set by the national law of Brazil. So many municipalities, not only Porto Alegre, tried this measure with different results, but the positive result they have in the end, made in 2001 possible to approve a national law which now was protecting all the city down this in front of the code on private property. So I think that it's very important to understand that in order to understand what common are in their different dimension, for example, the local authorities have a really strong importance. Like I would call it like a sort of duty of experiment, which can then be transmitted through the chain of the different, you know, the state level until the nation, which is what happened in Brazil. And I want to close with a small case of a city that possibly you know, because there were some articles on the New York Times, very very important in last weeks. That is Mariana Leda in Spain. It's a city of 2,700 inhabitants with zero rate of unemployment in Andalusia, where the rate of unemployment is 21%. So this is a communist town who was administered by the same communist mayor since 1979. And they bought 1,200 hectares of public land. They create a cooperative which reabsorb all the unemployed during the different period of the town. And it's interesting because they don't have police. They don't spend money on police. Usually the average is 35,000 euros in the small cities like this for police, and they don't spend this. And then they have the Red Sunday, in which people participate in cleaning, they call with the loudspeakers, and the people participate in public cleaning and building public land, agriculture on public land. So, I mean, this could be it looks like sometimes like a sort of myth or maybe something funny for people. But we have to think how many communities of this size we have around the world. In Italy, around 80% of the city has less than 10,000 inhabitants. So we can think that this is reproducible in other places. So I I wanted to underline these different cases in order to understand the notion of commons can be very different, but for me is mainly a process of resemantization of something that Devin Harvey defined as a romantic notion of something that never really existed because it was all in progress. Commons are not objects. Commons are the construction of awareness around important things for society. Thank you.
Thank you, Giovanni, for giving us very good illustrations that relate to process dimension of the commons. We had now two European perspectives, and we can go now with Vinod Raina's contribution into more, let's say, outsider's view on the crisis from the perspective of the commoner from India, primarily due to reason that we also know that Europe is running short with resources, and we can also, in this contribution, cover the issue of resources from the perspective of the commons and how the crisis in Europe is also, in a way, a crisis of resources.
Thanks, Vedant, and thanks for having me here in this European, predominantly European conference. I would tend to think that the crisis is not just Europe. The crisis is global. And it just so happens that there's a special aspect of that crisis that we're calling the European crisis. But the crisis is, in a sense, brought about by a world system which looks at processes of privatizing resources for maximizing profits. And that's not confined just to Europe. That's a global process. That's a global political system we're living in. It's not just an economic system. And it manifests in different ways. Now, from Asia, where I come from India, commons is both an alternative vision of how countries and the globe could be structured, and commons is also a resistance to this process of privatization and profit. It acts in both ways. Essentially, if we look at the progress of humanity, humans as compared to animals, there are two aspects which are predominant. One is the relationship of humans to nature, and the other is the production of knowledge, which is a particularly human trait. And this relationship with nature and knowledge are at the heart of the commons agenda, debate, or resistance that we're talking about. Now, let's look at nature. I'm going to dramatically refer to an event that happened in 1972 in a Himalayan village up in the Himalayas, a rainy village, where contractors, the men of a contractor came in the afternoon. And afternoon is a time when men normally go to the fields, and it's the women who are left at the homes. And they came in the afternoon with big chainsaws and pieces of paper saying that they have got a contract to cut the trees close to the villages where these women and were living. And the women saw that these people are going to be cutting these trees. Instead of panicking, they rushed out into the forests, and they hugged the trees. And they told these men, you will have to cut us along with the tree. We will not let you cut these trees. This became one of the high points of the environmental movement in India and across the world, called the Chipko movement. Chipko means to cling, to hug. And it was these very brave women who prevented these people from clear felling these trees. Now, they had an argument. They said, you got this contract to cut this timber so that you can make sports goods, cricket bats, hockey sticks. That's what the contract was for. But these trees provide us firewood for our food. This is where we cut the branches and take them home and we cook food using these branches. Our need is more important than yours. We will not let you take these trees. I think this highlights the conflict that we're talking about. Who controls resources for what purpose? And the question became, is the right of the women to cook food with this firewood more important than making cricket bats and hockey sticks? And who should have a right on this wood? Now, what the women were asking for was their right of a common property resource, because that forest didn't belong to anyone. It belonged as a common resource for villages around that forest, where they would actually take that resource and share that resource. Compared to the what is called the eminent domain laws, in which the state is the owner of all the properties and resources of a nation state, and therefore has a right to decide how it will give right to those resources through contracts, through licenses. And this is the conflict, which is the legal conflict, that who should have the right? The women or the humanity around for whom it acts as a common property resource, or the eminent domain of the state, which by the definition of the Constitution has the right and therefore power to decide to give it to it. Now, this is the classic example of the conflict between the state and the community over common property resources, be that forest, be that land, be that water, and we're seeing its manifestations across the world in many ways. The question here starkly comes for a country like India. You know, we're talking of the crisis of Europe, which is about 500 million people. We're talking of crisis in India, which is the crisis of 1.2 billion people. Now, I would tend to put to you, in terms of these dimensions, that there is a population equal to the population of Europe in a country, in a single country like India, I'm not talking of China, where it corresponds, which lives off the common property resources. About 500 million people of India, which is the total population of European Union, subsists on the basis of these common property resources, where you don't have tap water for which you pay a fee. You get water from the pond or the lake or the river as a common property resource. You lift water and you take it home. And it is not mediated by any processes of state or market. You have firewood, as I said just now, and you have land. In most of the Aboriginal land areas, there are no land rights. They don't have pieces of paper which give them land rights. But they've been living there for thousands of years, so they have what we call historical rights to that land. And the moment that land is given for a mining contract, for displacement by dams, by setting up industry, you have a conflict between these historical rights, which are common property rights, and the rights of the eminent domain of the state, which feels that it can ascribe this land to a corporation or a dam building agency because it has the right by the Constitution. So you have a constant battle between people protecting, as we say in India, land, water, and forests, where they feel that they have historical community rights, and with the state. This battle between the state and community is old, but enter the market, and as was just mentioned, the state aggressively then looks for facilitating the market to proliferate, and therefore passes these resources onto the market through mechanisms of state laws where this can be. So there's a process of dispossession of these common property resources happening together. I will leave it there as a major issue of conflict between the state market and the community, and it plays itself into very large movements, and most of the social movements in that part of the world, which includes Thailand, Philippines, the Mekong Delta countries, China, is about this conflict over control of resources. Who will control? Common property resources by the communities or the state, or through the state, the market. But there's one aspect which I'll come to when I talk about the question of knowledge. Now, I was a physicist. When I was doing a PhD in physics, the joke on our campus used to be, and this is early 70s, that if three persons had patent on their theories, then 99% of human activities would be paying a royalty to them. And these three persons were Newton, James Maxwell, and Einstein. Because 99% of our human activities somehow are based on the theories that they gave us. On electricity, on magnetism, speaking into the microphone, I should be paying royalty to Maxwell, for any motion to Newton, for any energy to Einstein. But we live in a world where production of knowledge and knowledge is a common that whoever produces it, it becomes a resource shared by the humanity. We don't pay a royalty to Einstein for having said E equal to mc squared or to Newton for laws of motion. So knowledge has remained in the world as a common property resource. It could be generated in any country by any person, but is available to all of us as a free resource. That's how we have lived till 1995, when in the process of neoliberalism, for the first time in the history of this world, we decided to craft laws where knowledge could be privatized. And we came to the new patent law regime, which not only said that we could privatize mathematical algorithms and computer codes, but we went a step further to get a nexus between knowledge and nature privatization when we said we could give life form patents. You could give a patent on seeds, you could give a patent on genes, which are aspects of nature. And this nature, which is available to us as one earth, as a common property resource. So we entered a new era in humanity when a Monsanto could get a patent on a seed, which was a common property resource of all the farmers of the world, or a pharmaceutical company could get a patent on genes, which is an aspect of nature because we're all composed of genes. And this aspect of privatizing knowledge is a regime under which we function, and its implications of university research and what is happening in production of knowledge. You know, we talk a lot about privatization of education in terms of universities and colleges as private entities. That is the reproduction of knowledge systems, institutions where knowledge is reproduced. But we often pay less attention to the privatization of the production of knowledge at the production stage itself, which is in the form of these. Now, it's a joke we used to have that if Einstein, Maxwell, and Newton had patents on their theories, then we would be paying royalty. But we didn't realize when we said this 25 years later, we would be in that regime. Now, the interesting part is, this knowledge system amongst the so-called ordinary poor people of the farmers and peasants is so vast in terms of farming, in terms of traditional health systems, the Chinese health systems, the Ayurvedic health systems of India, that it is the pharmaceutical companies who will steal this knowledge and then tweak it and then patent it so that they have stolen the common knowledge of people of thousands of years to produce some kind of a molecule or some kind of a patented drug and then reap profits out of it. So it's insane. It is obscene. And therefore, what I would put here is that it's not only a question of few laws to deal with problems of water, problems of land. It is basically two different worldviews, two different political views. One view which sees the humanity as part of nature the way any other biological entity is, and therefore a sharing of what the Bolivians call the Mother Earth. And the Mother Earth is a common heritage which we share. And these transactions are not transactions of profit. And to add to that, as people who go to universities and schools and colleges, and our minds are made from that, where the knowledge systems, whether it's produced in Europe or in China or in Israel or anywhere up in the Arctic, are knowledge systems which are part of that shared heritage and not open for profiteering. Now, it's a worldview. In the part where I live in India, it's a very, very important question. It's an important political question where, if I had time, I would tell you how social movements have had successes in crafting laws which transfer these rights to the people. For example, we have a law in India now which is called the Forest Dwellers' Rights, a right of people who live in forests traditionally and what rights they would have on the forest common property resources and the knowledge derived from the forest. And you would have heard of the classic case where the Indian community, civil society, and the state fought a patent law against patenting neem, which is a tree, a tree with many, many medicinal properties. And this was being patented in the United States. And therefore, the community and the state got together to say, we will not allow patenting the neem tree, because the neem tree has been, for about 10,000 years, a part of the Indian traditional common medicinal system, and this will not be traded for profit. If you want to use the neem products for your skin problems and whatever problems, take it free and take the knowledge, but not to a pharmaceutical company. So therefore, I would put it here that social movements in those parts of Asia, including China, and I would really want to say how this is in China because very little news comes out of that. Well, I put together a book. It's called The Victims of Development of Asia, The Dispossessed. It's an 11-country book, including China, of these processes of dispossession from commons and the resistances to them and how they have crafted different laws in that part of the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vinod. Also, thank you for reminding us that there are at least two dimensions of the commons, meaning alternative vision of society and worldview you just presented and the resistance. I also think that the recent Occupy movements had this had it in the focus. So I would like to open a discussion. I will use my role as a moderator to open a discussion and put one question to Saki, and later open the floor for all other questions and contributions. Maybe even Vinod can refer to the question as well. I'm concerned about the... actually, at one point, it's very encouraging that there is a demand to introduce explicit commons into writing constitutions. I even know that Iceland actually is writing a constitution that it has some people who are really willing to explicitly put some really definitions and chapters inside. So on the other hand, we have a state being more and more porous toward the pressures of the market. So I'm interested to learn in which way do you see state that is actually defend in this conflict that Vinod mentioned between community and the public, so between public and the common. How actually a state, which is being porous to the pressures of the market, can be a kind of platform or instance of defending the commons? Do you feel pessimistic or optimistic regarding the level in which way actually constitution can defend the common?
Good question.
So, well, the state is the mediator, right, between public and private interests. And I think we should demand that it play that role as mediator in both directions, because I think, as I mentioned earlier, it's not people, per se, that are the problem. I think this is really something that emerges for me out of looking at the situation of politics in various countries. I'm American originally, and people always ask me, are things better under Obama? And I really think that it's not really an issue of people. I think it's really about a system and what Vinod was mentioning earlier about a clash of worldviews and a clash of systems. It's not just worldviews, it's a clash of systems. I think the systems have a certain kind of logic inherent in them which produces certain kinds of results. And this was the point of departure from my talk earlier about legal subjectivity. Law produces certain kinds of subjects. Economics has a certain kind of rationality. There's a certain kind of rationality built into different systems, and this is the point of conflict. to get back to the question about whether I'm optimistic about the use of constitutions, I think that people must put pressure on the state to act as the mediator, because it's not just a mediator between people and corporations, actors. It's not just politicians, but it's a mediator between two worlds, between economics and between politics, right? And that we don't get overtaken by a kind of economic rationality. And the only way to do that is through pursuing projects of demanding popular sovereignty, right? That the state is actually accountable to us. And I think pushing the change in constitution will allow for more venues through which citizens can participate in that process of demanding that the government actually, right, have a political philosophy and represent people as opposed to an economic rationality.
I was thinking about the article 118.4 of the Italian Constitution, which has raised a debate on the circular subsidiarity, because the article say that not only the political institution are entitled to propose public policies, but the organization and the individuals in society could propose thing in the common interest, and the state would have to listen to them. But this is exactly what is not happening. So the article is there since 2001, was a big innovation when it was created. But the main idea of subsidiarity that still exists in our state is the sum of two components, a vertical component, which is the integration between the different level of the states, and another component, which is the dialogue between the state and society. But these two components are not capable of create a virtuous circle, because they reproduce, both of them, a sort of permanent asymmetry, in which I see many municipal governments protesting against the state because they don't give transfer, or they give transfer which are already blocked in what they can do with these transfers. And then when they go to society, to dialogue with society, they reproduce exactly the same asymmetry. They ask for global services, underpaid for producing public services, especially in the domain of social integration of people. The sector of migrants is always, and I have been working with the Roma people for a lot of time, and I mean, you don't deal with them. It's like if they were cemeteries. You give a global service to some association outside because you don't want even to think about them. So you ask to clean a gypsy camp and to educate the students and to do vaccines to them all together because you don't want to deal with the issue. So I think that we are still, unfortunately, far, but we have to fight. There was a fight it's called Active Citizen Network before the writing of the European Constitution, exactly for introducing in the European Constitution proposal the idea of circular subsidiarity instead of vertical and horizontal. But I think it's a battle we still have to do all together.
I think this is a very important question, and I'm glad you raised it, because the state is obviously the fulcrum on which this lies between the rights rights of the people, public, and the interests of the market. And the answer, of course, would have to be in the nature of the structure of the state. And this would bring us back to yesterday's discussion of democracy. It is on the answer is really to see that what is the structure of the state and through what democratic processes that state is constituted. And this would play, there would be some generalities across countries, but there would be vast differences. I would tend to think that the common between all states today is maintaining high growth rates, the economic rationality that Zaki mentioned. For China and India, it's an obsession that we must have 10% growth rates. A 10% growth rate is enormous. For countries which are more than a billion, to say that we want to maintain 10% growth rates and that Europe you're getting into negative growth rates, the stress on the resources you can imagine for energy, for transportation, for whatever, is just enormous. And therefore, China and India are looking for resources, natural resources, in Africa today. They're buying land in Africa so that they can have more food and more energy and minerals and whatever. So it's a disruption of these resources all over. But as I said, it depends on the nature of the structure of the state. If you get a state where there's a sizable proportion of people who represent the interests of people who talk about common property resources, as happens in India from time to time, that they get elected and they're there as members of the state, then you find passing of laws which are revolutionary. The Forest Dwellers Law is a revolutionary law. It talks about the rights of forest dwellers to forest resources, which will not be violated by market interests. So you do get, from time to time, laws of that kind, or what happened all over the world through the anti-dam movements. The anti-dam movement started in each country, the Three Gorges, the Narmada, the Pakmun, but when they combined together, World Bank had to change its policies of financing big dams because of precisely the dispossession of resources for local populations. So I would say that this is greatly a question of the nature of democracies. And where I would, as an outsider, comment on the European situation, I think finally the future of Europe would be determined by the nature of the democratic states that you elect. And if that remains a pro-people, there are hopes. If it continues to be pro-corporations, which the free trade agreements that the European Union is having with China and India are very much in the market interest, then the battle is very big. So I think this would play differently for each country.
So I just wanted to react to this. I mean, absolutely, I agree, because I mean, I'm talking about change, reactivating the constitutional structure, right, as a tool for political and legal emancipation. But I was actually very persuaded by your talk of, you know, about worldviews. And I think this is an extremely important point that, I mean, we have to think about, okay, structural change through the state. But there's also the question of, which I think Giovanni brought up, which is about underutilized mechanisms. Like, I mean, there are mechanisms for citizen participation and for communal participation. Why don't we use them? This is a big question. I think this really goes to the worldview, and I think that's why it can't just be a question about, you know, the answer lies in the state structure and in the structure of democracy, because it's about behavior. And in the examples that you gave, you know, what really strikes me, being from India, from a very different cultural context, in which, I mean, perhaps this is a bit romanticized, but there is maybe a closer connection to nature. I mean, when you live in forests and you actually do cut your own wood, you're actually really concerned about the forest itself, right? Whereas we as Europeans, we don't live in a world like that, right? And I think this is the really big question. So how do we, but we know at the same time that we can't live without nature, right? We have to protect our resources. Things like the oil that runs our cars, the electricity that keeps our houses going, we know that that comes from somewhere. We have a very distanced feeling of where that exactly comes from, but we know that we're dependent on natural resources, and the sustainability discourse is more in fashion than ever, right, to say. And I think this is the Western kind of contemporary modern understanding of holistic Mother Earth, is this new environmental movement that's talking about sustainability. But the problem is, if you lose the connection, that you actually in daily life come into contact with nature and you become concerned with it. This is, of course, natural, because we are what we do to some extent, right? We are these kind of homo economicus, very distanced from our politics, because we actually just decided that it's okay, maybe, like, for example, in the States, I know it's better here in Europe, to work 12 hours a day, or to consider your work community your only community. This we've kind of accepted that that's normal, that when we have free time, we go shopping. We go and consume things. I mean, It is about a shift of worldview, but the really big question is how do you translate that into political structures, into legal mechanisms?
Yeah.
It has to be also a change from the bottom up, from the individual changing their consciousness. Yeah.
Giovanni, yeah, had intervention. And
I think we have battles to do on at the same time on different
levels. For example, what did the constitutions of Ecuador and Bolivia show us in the last 56 years is that it's possible to reform the value of the constitution, including new cosmovisions. Because the introduction of the mother herds, which is called Pachamama in the constitution itself, so using also a language of historical importance, it's a big
paradigm shift, because it passed nature from an object of rights to a subject of rights. So I think that this constitution, we must study, we must know, yeah, we must diffuse much more than they are. They rest like a sort of niche. But these are a change of paradigm for all our constitution. And I think that a little bit this in the new constitution popularly done in Iceland was understood by the people who participated in his writing. But then, unfortunately, many constitutions remain a dead word. The second article of the Portuguese constitution is that the Portuguese state has as a goal to deepen participatory democracy. It has been 35 years after the revolution that we have this. And we have a centralized space, a state in all its 11 is centralized. We had mayors that until last year could be elected for 30 years and stay in power. So we have a completely paternalistic and patronage-driven states. So nothing related to participatory democracy. But in this moment of crisis, we are rediscovering, we have a multiplication of local experiences of participatory democracy, which are emotional because they build the capacity of people to understand what public interest is. I have very clear for the participatory processes I drive in several countries that this is not very easy. I remember that when we discussed on the idea to fund with public money in participatory budgeting, the first year usually there are a lot of cultural associations that propose things. Then they realize that everything becomes a common idea will be realized mainly with the instruments of the states, which are creating a tender for deciding who will be managing this cultural initiative and so on, because these are the rule of the states. So what do the cultural association do? They don't propose anything more because they are scared that their idea become a common idea and maybe they will be detached by this idea because someone else will win the tender. So they don't propose anymore. They even privatize knowledge on proposal because they are scared to lose the money that can come with this idea. So I think that we are still far in terms of evolution of society in order to arrive to a point in which we are able to recognize and manage together common goods.
Thank you. Now we are opening floor for discussions, input, different. Okay, so one, two, three, four. Okay. Sorry.
The first? Okay. Catherine Samary from France. I do believe that this issue is absolutely central for the whole debate we have. I wanted to bring in the debate first some informations of struggles which occurred recently in France around those issues. There was a world forum around the question of water in Marseille recently, where Suez, Veolia, the World Bank had their own official forum, and where there was a counter forum. And it was a concrete struggle against multinationals' control on water at the level of municipality. And I do believe that we have both to use the contradictions of existing law but more than that, develop a relationship of force. And there, the concrete relationship of force which was developed was through concrete example of what was the result of privatization of water for tariff, and what could be, and what was the concrete result for human being living of the public control of water. That's the first remark. So whatever be the limitation of laws and or existing contradiction, the question of legitimation of access to fundamental assets is the key issue. So there I do believe that what has been said for India and in general for the planet is the key issue, that is a political issue and battle, a concrete battle that the Indian population in Latin America has have developed very concretely in the recent period, articulating what they call also on their own culture, even religious approach, with the relationship between human beings and nature, and what they consider as human assets created by God. But we can, of course, present it in a very secular way also as a global human asset to be protected on the base of environmental issues and water, but the land, as a key question, like Polanyi presented the privatization of land, money, and human beings. Eh? But we can come back on those land, water, against the privatization of that. It's a key issue both to fight against the ongoing, on the existing system, and to present alternative. But there is also what the human being have created. Knowledge, as you say, education, but also health. And I think key battles, universal battles, there is an international conference these days in France also on the question of health and public service, education, health are key issues that we can interpret and present along the line of commons. That is, yeah. Common assets, meaning both natural assets that has to be protected against privatization and destruction, but also universal human rights to access to education, to health, and to knowledge against all those privatization. So I think it's also an international, when you are speaking about law, there are universal declaration for human beings, which are not at all, of course, respected, even for dignity, access to law, access to housing, access to basic needs. We must demonstrate that it is fighting against the existing capitalist system that we can protect those universal rights in favor of, I would call it for an eco-communist system.
So the you are the third one, and then okay, I know. So the gospodin Ovdje. Okay.
Technical system of the moderator.
Okay, as you wish.
Thank you.
Okay.
My name is Adam Filip. I'm from Hungary, and I want to ask you a question. In what terms is this festival really subversive? Because it seems to me, at least during these 3 days until now, that we really cannot imagine a world without the state. Can you imagine a world without the state? Good. Because for the panelists in these 3 days, for me, it's all about how to change the constitution, how to take over the institutions, etc. But you know, we heard the example from Iceland yesterday. It took I don't know how many months to create a new constitution. It is blocked. In Hungary, we have a new constitution forced by the new extremely nationalist government. So what? You know, it's a whole process of many, many times, whereas on daily basis, the privatization of knowledge, as you told from India, It's just thousands of patents are registered on a daily basis. I myself work on the issue of the seeds. And I can tell you that no one country, no one state is against the patent regime of patenting the seeds. So from where do we accept the change, you know? Through laws, through the constitution. And in this sense, for me, for example, the lecture of Saskia was very, very, very important, because what we lack is the territory itself. It's a virtue question, but in Europe, for me, the left movement has no agenda of land. It has no agenda of territory, because we say, oh no, it's the far right wing, it's the extreme right who is always dealing with territory and borders and etc. But without the link to territory, what do we defend? You know, we defend our rights. It's a nonsense for me. We have to go back to the concrete. In this sense, for me, in Latin America and in India, the communities linked to the territory are really struggling, because they are really defending their common property, which they are depending on. Now, questions? I don't know.
Okay. Yeah. We can collect, yeah? Okay. Okay, we can collect,
Yeah, I have a question, because you were talking on this clash of system and then clash of worldviews. I'm always in favor of struggles, and I'm always in favor of setting out an either-or, therefore, but I don't at all believe that setting out an either-or means to have a choice between only two options. And I'm very uncomfortable if the choice we have to make is formulated as a choice between order given by Mother Nature or capitalist destruction. I would like to ask the panel, please, is there not the possibility of having a third option? And if we are talking on commons, does that not mean commons are the goods to be shared between strangers? And is the city not a place, a meeting point of strangers coming together, and not of those who are already connected to each other and to Mother Nature? I don't think that that is the option I would like you to, and I don't, what you were telling about this small Spanish community, yes, it sounds nice, but what is with those people who don't want to live in a community built up by only 2,000 people, with all these kind of neurotics you can imagine immediately when you hear this?
Okay, we collect one more and then we go to... Okay.
Could we try to extend the concept of commons over to public media broadcasting systems? It is usual or perhaps common to talk about the state-owned broadcasting systems and infrastructure as public media. If we take it just as state-governed spaces, it is most likely that that we are going to end with different sorts of exclusions. Similar, if we try to conceptualize public media as in terms of public space, of Endlichkeit, as Jürgen Habermas did, it is also likely that that we will end with that we will produce different sets set of exclusions. So the question is, what do you think? Is it possible to reconceptualize the public media as common?
Mm-hmm. Can you start? Okay.
Somebody really wants to jump in. Do either of you really want to jump in? Vinod,
jump in. All right.
Hello.
Yeah, he does.
May I?
You, okay.
Okay. Okay, then one more. Okay.
Yes. Well, you know, if I have time, if not, I can pass. Of course.
No, no, of course.
Well, I just wanted to say that we are perhaps basing this discussion on assumptions that are actually the assumptions of the world as it is of the existing powers. Because you see, if for example you say, which is correct, within bourgeois society that indeed politics and economy are something different and have separate rationalities. But how does this view come into existence? Because you know, in capitalist society you consider that economic activity, i.e. production, employment and so on, are relations, contractual relations, between private contracting partners. Therefore, this belongs to the private domain of private contracts, and therefore it belongs to the civil society, which is excluded from obligatory regulations of the political domain, which socialists have been saying the separation no for now 200 years. And so I think that the separate rationalities should not be accepted. I think that hierarchical relations and command relations in the workplace should be considered political problems that should be fought as any other kind of hierarchical relations that are inimical to the most elementary notion of liberty. And that's one point. I accept it as part of reality, but it's something that should be fought rather than accepted. Because if you accept it, then it happens what many people were actually refusing, that if you accept this dichotomy with civil society and the state, economics and politics and so on and so forth, that means that you are erecting over your own head an authority that you should demolish rather than build up, which is of course the state, but the state just one form of it. And the third point, where I have to be very, very succinct, and therefore I have to simplify, I'm sorry, is if you talk about the commons, well, be very careful, because, you know, if we speak about defending the communal ownership of some assets, the idea of property is strictly opposed to the idea of the commons for the very simple reason that the commons are something that are indivisible, and that if it's indivisible, that means that it cannot be distributed, redistributed, sold, and bought. There is no absolute control. And the Roman law defines property as absolute and exclusive control. And this is in direct contradistinction to the idea of commons, which is not like that. And we see that in patenting and the knowledge problem. So how can you possess, buy and sell entities that are for a linguistic nature, which are, for example, not reduced by being used? War and Peace by Tolstoy is not getting smaller when more million people will read it. Therefore, if it's not, there are no limits, then there's no property. There's no valuation, there's no price. Therefore, the commons are, on the one hand, opposed to the legal specification of property. It cannot be exclusive. And, of course, it's opposed to the market, to money, and so on and so forth, because if it cannot be divided, if it cannot be used, and it cannot be used up, that's why it's not a limited resource, then the idea of property becomes absurd. And so these delimitations that are originating in the bourgeois enlightenment project, influenced very much by the rationality of Roman law and the pre-modern ideas about the state, authority, and so on and so forth, should not be accepted unquestioningly, even if we are trying sometimes to work within the system. We as subversives, okay, we should indeed always keep critically in perspective that these are notions that are not only notions that we oppose, they're also false. Thank you.
All right. Yeah. I don't pretend to have the intellectual capacities to answer any of these questions. I must start by saying that, because many of these are not quick questions. They're very profound truths, so one can only agree with many of them rather than answer them. I didn't want to theorize. I just wanted to be on a very practical plane, but some of these questions, and particularly yours, are forcing me to talk about some kind of theorization which will make me very unpopular here in Europe, but are necessary. I think at the root of the kind of question that particularly you asked, and our friend from Hungary, about is the state the answer, what about the territory? I feel hopeless about cities. I must tell you this, that I don't see future of this world and humanity centered in cities. Because to me, cities by definition are unsustainable. And I'm saying this, and I'll explain a bit about this. The essential rupture that I think that has happened, and much more in Europe, and as I said, I'm going to be unpopular by making references to Europe being non-European, is the disjunction between two sets of people who produce and people who consume. And as this rupture becomes more and more, these problems are going to be much more binary and much more difficult to solve. The problem, as you characterized, that can we not talk of a city where the common property resource is also of between strangers and not the connected community? The trouble is that if you have a 16 million person city like New Delhi, four times, I think, the Croatian population, I think by definition, I think it requires systems which are not based on common property resources to meet those kind of needs of 16 million people's food and water and housing and stuff like that. And people, 16 million people, who are not themselves involved in primary production. They're not producing their own food. They're not close to water systems which they're taking care of. And therefore, systems of governance which can make consumption systems for these people is where the market thrives. That's where the market thrives. And that's where the common property resource cannot be, because you're so far away, distant from those resources that you require. And this is, to me, I'm sorry to say, the tragedy of Europe. Having had the resources satisfied from the colonies for about 250 to 300 years, and then finding the loss of colonies, and therefore to look for those resources through legitimate state and constitutional and international trade treaty routes, is where we are today. Where we are today, that they had to be crafted, because the populations have to be sustained who are not primary producers. I mean, even in China and Hong Kong, where I go and teach for 2 months, I ask, and this might surprise you, I ask 22-year-old graduate students, so where do you get your rice from? And she says, from the supermarket. And I say, where does it reach the supermarket? I don't know. And I'm talking about that kind of problems. I mean, these might be problems which are outside, you know, state market mechanisms, but we are into that kind of ruptures of minds. And therefore, till we live in a system where a large humanity of cities is in the service sector and not in primary production, or in industrial sector, which requires resources to be brought, minerals and mines and coal and energy from far off places, this disruption, the response of a governance system, perforce is market, because you have to get things from distance. So therefore, I personally cannot conceive of a 10 million population in a city which is in this ruptured state of a consumer and a producer, then situating itself in a commons paradigm. It's, to me, inconceivable. And therefore, and that's the trouble, then you'll say, oh, so therefore you're saying we should delimit the cities, or we should get rid of the cities. I'm sorry, maybe yes. Maybe yes, because I'm not sure that how we can sustain this. And I'm not talking of cities of Europe. I'm talking of New Delhi and Mumbai, 17 million people. It's not possible to do that. And that's why the connected communities, which still form half the population of this earth, 3 billion people, are the ones who are the defenders of the commons. Because for them, their connected life is based on that. For the consumer, which is not a producer, that's not a major question. The major question is, I must have my apricots and my strawberries in times when it doesn't grow in my country. It can come from some other place. It must be in the supermarket. I want to consume it. Therefore, we can't escape, as we say in India, certain questions of the very nature of structure of societies that we have crafted, which we now feel are in many ways unsustainable in cultural terms, in resource terms, but we're looking for solutions to sustain them. And that's my problem. I don't know how we can sustain. I can go a lot on that. Public media, your question is very, very, public media should be common, but there is no public media. There is private media for the public. Media is the most privatized form of systems we have. It's called public because we go as consumers to buy that newspaper and television. But it's not done by public. And there are public media attempts in the world which are talking about community media and not media by houses which have consumers, and consumers not for news, for advertisements. Media today is basically a source for revenue of advertisement, not news is secondary. And finally, the question that Catherine asked from water. I think water is really an area where probably the urban and the rural can combine in defining that what should be common. Because it is a finite resource, it is a vital life resource, everyone needs it, and it is available in the world equally, more or less, except for the deserts. Therefore, it's not far off like the forest or something. And I think, therefore, water can be a battleground for us to fight this battle. But more important, as a scientist, I would say, just as we have heritage sites of the UNESCO, which we say Angkor Wat or Taj Mahal belongs to the whole humanity and not just India or Cambodia, scientifically, water is such a unique chemical that it should be called a heritage chemical, common to the humanity, because if I had time, I would say that it breaks all the laws of science in order to sustain life. So I would really say that from completely secular, and I know there are religious connotations which we use, from secular ideas, water can be a much bigger battleground than perhaps land in reclaiming the common. Thank you.
Thank you. Giovanni, did you wanted to refer to some of the questions?
Yeah, I also have to admit my limits because some of these questions are, so big that cannot be really answered. But I'm fascinated by the idea of commons as a place to share among strangers, definitely. But also I have the same doubt because I have been working in a lot of big cities in the southern world, and I have the same feeling as Vinod's. If I try to imagine, I never try to imagine a society without the state, because I think that if I would, I would have to substitute the state with something else, which is similar in the concept. So maybe we could call again states. I tell you that because working for 15 years on participation, even if I'm an optimist and I saw wonderful results in terms of pedagogy of the people participating, I noticed that egoism is the base of everything, even of the mobilization of people. Many persons participate in participatory processes because they think they can gain something personally. Maybe they change their idea, because if you build a good common space in which people is forced to listen to each other, you can really change things. I'm positive on that. I saw so many examples. But for example, Porto Alegre some years ago tried for 5 years to dispollute the lake. And being that they had the participatory budgeting, people did not want, because they were saying the majority of people participating in Porto Alegre is people that have been excluded by from politics for a long time. So they were saying, we have priorities. Now that we are running the public resources, we want to make our priorities win. And who the more participates, the more has to win, which is a principle of self-centering. Because if you have a small community and you put a small community and a larger community together, the larger will only win if you use the majority as an issue central for deciding. So you have to build something else. So after 5 years that people were saying, no, this polluting the lake, this is for rich people, the one that think that sustainability, what is this? This is for people who have dogs and want to have a park, who want to eat organic thing because they have the money to use this niche of the market. No, it's not for us. We want houses. We want paving in our streets. And so for 5 years, Porto Alegre continued to do this and couldn't spend money on the dispollution of the river. Until they have a genial idea, was trying to mix the request of the people and something that could create a first idea of what common can also be a positive thing for individuals. And so they decided to put a rule in the participatory budgeting that was that the first communities to be relocated from the slums were the slums that were located along the river in order to start to dispollute all the river going into the lake. And after 2 years, the first beach was reopened after 30 years to swimming. And all the poor that had to go, they never swim in their life, because the first sea in Porto Alegre, which is called Porto, but is 100 kilometers far from Porto Alegre. So the first beach is 100 kilometers far, is Torres. Okay, so these people started to swim during the summer in the reopened beach on the lake. And they started to understand that this was something that was changing their quality of life. And they started to fund the dispollution of all the other beaches in the lake for the next 10 years. So that now there are, I think, 12 reopened beaches on the lake. So I think the problem is this mediation between the individual legitimate desire to gain something and the common. When I look at the ladder of participation of Sherry Arnstein, the top of the ladder is self-management of people. This ladder was thought about, was created in 69, so it has clearly an ideologic bias. The idea of the self-management is the best. In my experience in these 15 years, and it's not a lot, but something. I think that the tension that exists in co-management is something that is even more productive in terms of creating awareness of the different needs that coexist in the world. So I think that something like the states, if it's not the states that we imagine now, we must have. And recently, there is a big debate on who states the rules of participation. I use a lot of Rosa Luxemburg sentence, which is, I would never like to go to a party where I cannot dance. It means I want to know the rules before going to the party. If I cannot dance, I don't go. Okay, so the idea is building the rules of participation together. But I saw many negative sides of this. Because in Porto Alegre in the last 6 years, since the municipality changed, a lot of movement took power of the participatory budgeting, and because they have every January the revision of the rules start stepping back. So it was forbidden to have popular delegates for more than 1 year, and now they can be elected for 7 years. We have always the same usual suspect participating in the participatory budgeting, because there was this rule, who the people decide to have. So the problem is that creating rule is a place in which you can create big asymmetry of power. And so it's important to have someone who try to shake you when you take these shortcuts. So I want to close with this question. When the convergence of interest can be can configure like a common value to fight for. Because in the last months in Portugal, we had an enormous series of demands in the participatory budgeting of land for urban agriculture, which has never had been recognized by the Portuguese states. It's a minor thing, it's not interesting. And so people started to do illegal agriculture. I have a student doing a thesis on Cape Verdean illegal agriculture around the city of Lisbon, and it's growing. And in one moment, during the crisis, some municipalities started to stop eviction, saying, why do we make people suffer in this moment of the history in which they are trying to survive? So nobody will use that land. Developers are not interested to build anything in this moment. So let's leave the Cape Verdean build their urban agriculture, who integrates their salary, who integrate all elderly people, immigrants. So they have a series of positive outcomes altogether. So an holistic vision. And this is a cultural shift, because for the first time, these municipalities, instead of respecting the law, they were starting to think about what people was doing illegally as a solution and not as a problem. Before, they were seeing this as a problem, has happened with slums in all the southern world for decades. And now they are thinking, but these are investments that people is doing on the territory, on the land, building solution for themselves that the state is not able to give. So this cultural shift for me is very important. So I think that we have to start to try to recognize when individual demands are configuring something new. The growth of community land trust in the United States and England and Canada in this moment is, emotioning. Because it's not just about land, it's about affordability of housing on that land. And so I think that we can reconfigure the way in which we are doing neighbors in this way, because there is a demand that is showing results. So maybe, okay, I don't know. I didn't give any solution, but just to launch new things in the debate, sorry.
Yeah, and they are also very much relevant for the next session on urban commons. So, taking into account our time constraint, I invite Saki also to answer the questions and maybe give a closing word by your side.
So I just want to react to this point about cities that Vinod made earlier about cities. I don't have such a dismal view of cities. I think if we did, we would have nowhere to go in Europe. And I'm more optimistic than that. And I also want to point out that yes, okay, cities might have certain kinds of constraints, as you're mentioning. The natural resources have to be brought in from the outside. There's the problem of distance. There's the problem that we live in a finite world of finite resources. But I think I want to go back to this paradigm shifting idea that you brought in earlier, which is about reproduction versus production. Because also, commons and wealth is produced not just from a system of production, as you know, in the world of finite resources, that's more of a concern, right? But in terms of resources like education, culture, those things are actually produced out of the close intermingling and interaction that takes place in places like cities. Civilizations were born out of cities. So I don't want to say but just because there's the problem of, okay, natural resources and how you bring in natural resources, I think it has more to do with standards. I think we need to redefine what needs are. What are our real needs? What are the let's bring in some new metrics for understanding needs and make them more basic, because I think the problem is that currently as people live in cities, yes, it's completely unsustainable because people have needs far, far beyond the minimum. I mean, we're consuming. I think I heard some strange statistic like people are the lifetime of a shirt from H&M is 7 wears, okay? People wear something for 7 times and they throw it away. This is the average, this is the kind of consumption level that we're talking about. And yes, that's entirely unsustainable. I don't know if it's the organization of cities that actually produces that. But I think I just want to briefly say that I don't have that dismal of a view on cities. The earlier comment I want to go back to is the one that was made by this man drinking water in the back over there about you know, is this really subversive? I'm sorry. Is this really a subversive form? Because, yeah, I have the really big danger of sounding like a liberal, you know, when I'm sitting here and I'm talking about, okay, let's reinforce our constitutional process, let's reinvigorate rights. I agree, that doesn't sound very subversive. And actually, in fact, part of my presentation, which got left out because I'm very bad with time management, is basically that, you know, what really brought me into all of this was time that I spent with a theater community in Rome called the Valle. It's the Teatro Valle. It's one of the oldest theaters in Rome, one of the oldest theaters in Europe. And what happened there was an occupation. Okay, so a pretty subversive act, an occupation. Occupation of the theater community there, resisting the police from entering. It's in the real anarchical tradition of squat, okay? Like really squatting in the theater, preventing the police from entering, resisting the right-wing government. How does the law come in? I'm still, so maybe I have to explore whether I am really a liberal or not. I have a belief, that the law can be emancipatory. I don't know if that's a liberal view, but I think it can. I think that we can reclaim the law as a plane for struggle. Okay, and that's my basic concept, is that it's not to create new documents and new rights and new constitutional processes. I think that's bullshit. I agree with you. I mean, we have enough. We have all kinds of charters and declarations that say all kinds of promises of all types. That's not what at all that I'm saying. I'm talking about reclaiming law as a plane for struggle. So that means that, you know, in the case of the Valle, the case of the Valle occupants, what protected them in the end from having the police enter is that they claimed a legal status, okay? They submitted a document which was never before seen by the notaries. They kind of didn't know what to do with it, quite frankly. They were like, well, I guess we have to notarize it, but we don't really understand why we're supposed to do it. Because it was a document that said, we're forming ourselves as a comitato, a committee, in view of becoming a foundation, okay? And this was a legal protection. It put a legal protection around the occupation so that now it's still going on, okay? If they hadn't done that, it probably would not be going on. And the kinds of projects that I'm really interested in pursuing are the projects that look at things like, okay, comparative studies between countries, looking at their laws to find tools for protecting occupants, okay? Protecting occupation movements, protecting the law as a plane for struggle. Okay, so that's my point. I agree. I mean, it sounds like when you claim rights and you that it could sound very liberal. But I don't think we should give up on the law and just say, oh, that's something for the liberals to deal with. You know. Okay. So another point that was made. You know, as Vinod said, these questions are so great, because they really get at truth, right? The biggest questions that we can ask about what it is to be human, to some extent, are being brought out by the discourse on the commons, and that's really what I love about the commons, is that it brings out these issues about what does it mean to be a part of a community, right? What does it mean to live as a community while respecting individual autonomy, which was the point by this man over here, right? That we have a kind of a romanticized idea about communities, the commune. We want 1968 back. You know, it's a kind of, right, there's a kind of a idea there that we want to reclaim this romantic view. But the vision there, these are questions that people will be debating forever. Yes, okay, communitarians on one side believe that community is something which is culturally embedded. So the lines of who is in and who is out are drawn by traditional things like ideology and community, the locality, the geography of a region, which may not be so relevant in the world that's being produced today. So I talked earlier about how neoliberalism produced a certain kind of man in a certain kind of world. So did political liberalism, right? And this is why the subversive forum is important, because we're critiquing not just neoliberalism, but political liberalism. I mean, political liberalism also produced an idea that individual autonomy, your right to exit the community, negative freedoms, your freedom from being interfered with, your freedom to speak, your freedom to do, as opposed to a state obligation or a community duty or a community responsibility to provide you with certain kinds of things. And this is going back to a debate which is, you know, just a beautiful and debate that probably will never get reconciled with between what is real human emancipation. Karl Marx says human emancipation is not just political emancipation, right? It's material emancipation. We must, to really have rights like the freedom to speech, you must at least have the minimum amount of material conditions to participate in politics, right? And so I think that these are the kinds of debates that are being brought out by the commons. I don't know if they'll ever be reconciled, but I think that it's extremely promising that we can't give up on debating these things and reclaiming some of these old discourses to find new solutions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Saki. Thank you all, Giovanni and Vinod, for taking part in this discussion. We are about to continue in approximately 15 minutes. Now we will have a short break, and we are going further with the focus on urban commons, another cities possible, with a question mark.